It's a privilege to be here. The Apostle Paul said unto me, it's this grace given that I should preach. And it is a grace. It's a privilege to preach the Word of God, the eternal Word of God, the living Word of God. And what a privilege it is to be trusted with this Word and to be able to teach the Word and preach the Word to others. Open the Bible down to the book of Matthew chapter 11. And in verse 20, Jesus had finished, you know, you're talking about John the Baptist and how the people had responded to John the Baptist and him, and those two were so totally different, and they responded by rejecting both of them. They rejected John, and they rejected Jesus. And then the Bible said, then began he to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Now, our Lord Jesus is talking about the cities right around him. He had sent his disciples out. They had worked miracles. Jesus had done most of his mighty miracles right there close to Capernaum. In fact, remember that's where he healed Peter's mother-in-law. She was very sick, and there he had healed a blind man, and Jairus' daughter he had raised up. And so he had done so many ways. The woman with the issue of blood was healed there in Capernaum. And so the Lord had done mighty works there, and yet they didn't repent. Have you ever heard the thought that, boy, I wonder if God just sends enough judgment on people, maybe they'll repent? But, you know, we found out that really is opposite case most of the time. When God sends his judgment, it's usually because he's waited and waited and waited and waited very patiently for them to repent, and they've hardened their hearts. Then there was nothing left but judgment. But I remember the Bible says the goodness of God leads us to repentance. God's goodness. Now remember what he said when he sent Jonah over to Nineveh. And he said, you know, he said, God's judgment is going to come. He's going to destroy the city. And those people believed the preaching of Jonah, and they repented. And the king of the city said, oh, let's bow down and fast and pray, and maybe God will spare us. And God did. He spared that city of Nineveh because they repented. Now, Jesus said the biggest problem is that they didn't repent. That's what he said. He began to upbraid them, to correct them, to chide them, to come down strong upon them, because they had seen his mighty works, but they didn't repent. Those works should have caused them to say, man, God is with us. Who else could do what he has done except God in the flesh? He is the fulfillment of the prophecies, but they did not repent. Did you know the Bible teaches repentance is necessary for salvation? Except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. The word repent is the Greek word metanoia. It means to have a thorough change of heart attitude that leads to a change in action. Now, repentance itself doesn't save. Repentance leads to faith in Christ. Repentance is more than sorrow. Some people get caught and they're sorry for their sins, but they're sorry only that they got caught with their sins. They didn't really repent. Repentance means that I see God's judgment is upon sin, and God hates sin, and I'm a guilty sinner, and Lord, I am sorry for it, but I'm more than just sorry. I'm sorry enough to quit. I'm sorry enough to seek a remedy. And repentance is twofold. In other words, if I'm walking in unbelief and rejection of Christ, when I turn and believe in Christ, I have repented because I've changed direction. I had a change of heart attitude about Jesus. It has been pointed out that repentance requires a change of heart attitude about sin, because a person who's out there who's a sinner and loves his sins, he begins, instead of loving that sin, he sees that God hates sin. That sin's going to bring him under the wrath of God and the judgment of God. And so he looks at sin and he says, sin is a bad thing instead of a good thing. Then he has a change of attitude about himself. Whereas he thought, well, I'm a pretty good fellow. I'm as good as anybody else around me. I live a pretty good life. And he looks at himself and says, no. God says, my very best is still as wickedness in his sight. And I'm a sinner and I'm under judgment of God, rightly so. So he changes his heart attitude about himself. And then he changes his heart attitude about the Savior. Whereas he was maybe necessary for somebody else, but now he sees him as an absolute necessity for his own soul. I must have him. And so he turns to Jesus and calls on him to save him. And so repentance is necessary. Jesus upbraided them because after they had seen all his mighty works, they still did not change their attitude, their heart attitude about sin or about themselves or about Jesus himself. And so he said unto them, verse 21, woe unto thee, Chorazin, woe unto thee, Bethsaida, for if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee had been done in Sodom, they would have repented. You know, that's something that they would remain to this day. They would have repented and they wouldn't have been destroyed. They would have remained. But I say to you that it should be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. And there's two or three thoughts here. First of all is there's degrees of sin. Anyone who says that all sin's the same is obviously not thinking very clearly, because it's very clear that there are differences and different degrees of sin. The Bible teaches it, Old Testament and New Testament. We have our laws set up in this country based on it. We have little things like misdemeanors, and we have misdemeanors of first, second, third degree. Then we have felonies of the first, second, third degree. Then we have capital crimes that require execution. And certainly it is not the same to tell a lie as it would be to cut somebody's head off. Anybody who's thinking at all can see that not all sins are the same. It's obvious that sins are different, and there's different punishment for different sins. And here he's saying, these people in Tyre and Sidon, they're going to be better off in a judgment than the people around here at Chorazin and Bethsaida who had seen these miracles and did repent. Those people, if they had seen those miracles, they would have repented. And he said it's going to be more tolerable for Sodom, that terrible city full of sodomy, and it's going to be more tolerable for them in a judgment than for Capernaum, because they didn't see what the people in Capernaum had seen. And so if they had, Jesus said they would repent. Isn't that interesting? Now, obviously, also you see in this that there are degrees of punishment. There's degrees of punishment in hell as there is degrees of reward in heaven. You see that very clearly, can't you? It's going to be more tolerable in the judgment for some than it will be for others. Hell is going to be hotter for some than it will be for others. Those people who have seen the mighty works of God and rejected him, they'll have greater judgment than those people out there who have not seen those miracles and seen that, the wonderful works of God. All are responsible, and all will face judgment who reject Christ, but it'll be more tolerable for some than for others. You remember what the Bible says over in the book of Revelation, chapter 20, when he says that sinners will stand before God, small and great, and the books are opened, and another book is opened, which is the book of life, and the dead are judged out of those things which are written in the books according to their works. In other words, what God is doing and what he is saying is he writes in his book every sin that every person commits. So the greater the number of sins in there, they're going to be the greater the judgment of God and the greater judgment. God's a fair God. God is a just God. And so the more a person sins, the greater is going to be his judgment. The Bible teaches it all the way through. And the book of Revelation, he says, at that last day when he opens the books, that they're judged out of those things according to their works. The more wickedness, the more sin, more judgment. It'll be a lot more tolerable for some in the day of judgment than will be for Hitler. It'll be a lot more tolerable for some than it will be for Stalin and for Mao Zedong and some of those fellows who have murdered millions of Christians. It'll be a lot more better judgment for some than it will be for them. It'll be better for these people in the far-flung areas of the world who have just heard one missionary in one time heard of Jesus, it'll be more tolerable for them than those people in this country who've been bombarded with the gospel over and over and over and hardened their hearts. The scriptures definitely teach degrees of sin. Some sins are worse than others, and degrees of punishment in hell for those sins. Just as he says, it's also fair for Christians, it's going to be rewards in heaven according to our works. Heaven is not a reward. Everybody understands that, I hope you know. Heaven is a grace. Heaven we receive by receiving Christ as our Savior. You don't deserve heaven. And there's nothing we can do ever to do that would deserve heaven. Heaven comes to us for salvation. But rewards in heaven are according to our works. As we work faithfully for Christ and do what we do for His glory, the more we do for His glory, the greater our reward. He's going to reward us for our faithfulness. You've been faithful over a few things, I'll make you a ruler over many. And he said, you know, the thing is, our faithfulness to Christ will be rewarded when we stand before Him. It's going to be a wonderful day. I think sometimes that people we don't hear much about, people who are just, like for instance, some person that's bedfast or home fast, they can't get out and go anywhere, and yet, boy, they just pray all the time and bombard heaven for the glory of God, and they pray for preachers, and they pray for missionaries, and they pray for the works of God, and I think maybe someday at the judgment seat, we're going to see some things. And those people are going to be standing up there rewarded when some of us out here that are out here doing the work are going to be lesser down the line than they were, because they were there constantly serving God with prayers day and night. The scriptures tell us it will pay to serve the Lord. The Lord is righteous, the Lord is just, the Lord is fair in every way, and heaven will be worth it all. And you can be sure that whatever you do for the Savior will be rewarded. If you do it for the Savior, not do it for a pat on the back or for the praise of man, because that doesn't get a reward. But if we do it for Him and do what we do for Him, we'll be rewarded. And at that time, Jesus answered and said, it's interesting the instruction this is, He answers it. There's never a question asked. But He answered it and said, I think Jesus was reading the minds of the people, and He knew that they had questions, and so He went ahead and gave them an answer, even though they didn't express the question. Did you know the Lord knows what you think? The Lord knows our thoughts. That's a serious thing in its own right. He knows what we think as well as what we speak. And at that time, He answered and said, I thank Thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because that Thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. For even so, Father, for it seemed good in Thy sight. You know what Jesus was saying here? He's saying these scribes and Pharisees, these religious leaders who have all the praise of the people, they were blind as bats when it came to spiritual things. They didn't really perceive that Jesus was the Christ. They didn't perceive the love of God in sending a Savior. But the common folk out there did receive Him gladly. And they believed in Him and followed Him. And so he was saying, Lord, I'm so glad you've revealed that to the common people, the ones that these up-and-up people look out as babes. You have revealed it to them. And these up-and-ups, they don't get it. I'm afraid that we've got an awful lot of people who are in the higher echelons of Christian service today who don't get it. Did you see it in the paper this week? There's a church up in the Northeast. And it was a Pentecostal church, and they decided to combine with some Muslims. And they invited all the Muslims in, and the pastor of that church told his people, said, privately, I've been worshiping Allah and Muhammad, and I'm encouraging all of our people in our church to realize that Allah is God too, as well as the God of the Bible. Totally blind as a bat spiritually, man lost as the devil himself, that would make a statement like that. I mean, I can say that he's a lost man, because no man who's saved will call Jesus accursed, and only by the Holy Spirit can you call Jesus Lord. And he's calling some false idol Allah, and some false prophet Muhammad, and calling them equal to Jesus. I'll tell you, folks, we're living in some sad times right now. And the spiritual leaders, so-called, sometimes are the ones who are the blindest spiritually of all. And that's what Jesus said here, you know. Lord, you've revealed to the babes, but these people who are the ones that are up and out, muffy muck people, they don't get it. They haven't really received it at all. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. The only way you can know Jesus is to know the Father. The scriptures say, if you deny the Son, you also have not the Father. There are churches that talk about Jesus only. They call themselves the Jesus only people. And they actually deny that God is God. They say all that's in Jesus, Jesus is God. And they deny the Father, his rightful place. And then there are others who call themselves Jehovah's Witnesses who deny Jesus is equal to God. And they're equally wrong. You see, the scriptures say that Jesus is God, the Holy Spirit is God, God the Father is God. There's a Holy Trinity here. And if you deny the Son, you deny the Father. You have not the Father. That's what he said. Now, I'm not saying these people are not sincere. There's some of them are very sincere. Some of them get out and work and work and visit and knock doors and do everything in the world. But they're sincerely wrong. They can be sincere and be sincerely wrong. You know, I've mentioned this to you before. If I got out here on 75 and if I'm going north, I can drive forever thinking I'm going to arrive somewhere down Tampa or down south. And I may be sincere, but I'm sincerely wrong. I'm not going to make it if I'm heading north. Right? I can be sincerely wrong. And there's a lot of people who are sincerely wrong spiritually. You act like you've done that before. Somebody over here laughing. Which way is north?
He says, I'll be right with them.
On the tape, would you edit that out, please? All right. Even so, Father, it seems good in your sight. But the scripture here said, if you don't know the Son, you don't know the Father. And if you don't know the Father, you don't know the Son. And the Son reveals the Father, and the Father reveals the Son. We study the scriptures and the Lord reveals himself to us in his word. How marvelous and wonderful. Now look at the invitation Jesus gives. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I think there's a lot of people in this world that are heavy laden. They're laden down with all kinds of burdens of guilt and they're burdened down with unforgiveness in their heart and bitterness, and they've been mistreated, and so many things have happened. Some of them are burdened down with physical illness. Some are burdened down with financial difficulties and problems. Some whose all their own family members have turned against them, and there's disagreements in the family, and so many burdens that people bear in this whole world. And our Savior is opening his heart to the people, and he's saying, come unto me. Come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. And a marvelous, wonderful invitation from our Savior. Do you have a burden? Is there something burdening your heart? Is there something that's weighing you down? Bring it to Jesus. That's what he said. Jesus said, come to me and bring your burden to me. If you're heavy laden, if you're burdened down with care, bring that burden to me. We used to sing the song years ago, bring your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. Leave it there. I heard someone say one time they tried and they tried and they tried, but every time they try to lay the burden down, then pretty soon you're picking it back up again. They just got to continually lay it down, because we have a tendency to want to bear our own burdens, and we feel like we ought to be loaded down and we ought to be burdened with these things. And so instead of really casting our cares upon Him, we want to bear them ourselves, and we do ourselves much ill when we do that. We deny Him His rightful role. He said, bring your burdens to me. Cast your cares upon me. I care for you. Why should you carry them when I want to carry them for you? It reminds me of the story of the years ago up in Kentucky. There's a man on a wagon. He's pulled by a horse, and he's riding along, and he sees this fellow walking along, and he has a 50-pound bag of potatoes on his shoulder. And he's just trudging along, and the fellow stops the horse in the way. He says, man, bring that up here. I said, man, why should you be walking with that? So he gets up and sits down beside of him, and he pulls off, and he looks over, and he's still holding those potatoes. He said, man, don't you know this wagon's able to hold those potatoes? You don't have to carry them on your shoulder anymore. Put them down here and let the wagon carry the burden. Well, we're just about as foolish. When we have a Savior who cares for us, who said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And yet we want to come to Him, but then we want to bear our own burdens. Man, cast your burdens upon the Lord. He cares for you. This is what the Scripture said. It's not a mark of spirituality, by the way, to run around with a long face because you're bearing a burden. It's a mark that you failed to come to the Lord and leave your burden with the Lord. It's no mark of spirituality. It's a mark of immaturity spiritually if we carry our own burdens all the time instead of casting them on Him. What does the Scripture say? Cast your cares upon Him, for He cares for you. And so if you're carrying them yourself, you're not doing what the Scripture said, and you're not spiritual by it. You're denying the Lord His rightful role in your life when you bear your own burdens. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. What a marvelous, wonderful promise. Think of what he's saying here. Look at the end of verse 29. Take my yoke upon you. Now, you know what a yoke is, especially if you have two animals, and there's a big wooden harness that you put over them, and you put that over the necks of the animals, and you have to have two animals that are pretty well the same size and the same attitude or spirit, and you put that yoke over them, and two of them carry that load much better than just one can carry the load. And Jesus said, I've got a yoke. In other words, what he's saying, he's saying, you come to me, that doesn't mean you're going to be without any responsibility, that your life is going to be a life of untroubled nothingness. He said, no, I've got a job for you to do. I want you to get yoked up with me in this job that I've got. Bring your burdens to me, bring your cares to me, get in yoke with me, and we'll get this thing done. He's saying, I want you to work with me. The Apostle Paul uses the expression. It moves my heart when I think about it. The Apostle Paul said, we are co-laborers together with Christ. You know what he's saying there? The way that's written in the original language, what he's saying there is, you and I are equal. What? In the work of the Lord, Jesus is saying, I depend on you and you depend on me, and we work together and get the work done. Can you imagine that he would humble himself to that low spot and allow us to be co-workers together with him? Co-laborers together with Christ. My, we're in the yoke together. We're to work together. We're to pull the load together. Notice what he said now. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Now the next thing we do is after we take the yoke, we say, Lord, we're going to get in yoke with you. We're going to serve you. And he says, then learn. And this is in the continual sense. Keep learning of me. Keep learning of me. We never, ever, ever get to the place where we have arrived. Paul said, not that I've already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I'm also apprehended of Christ Jesus. I'm striving, I'm moving forward, I'm pressing toward the mark, I'm forgetting the things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark. And so he's saying the same thing to us. Continually learn of him. This is why we go to church. This is why it's important that we be in Sunday school and church and prayer meeting, because we're continually learning of our Lord. None of us ever get enough. We never can. And so we need to constantly be gaining more knowledge, growing grace in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So he said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. You know what he's saying? If you learn about me, you're going to be like me, and it'll do away with your pride. Meek and lowly. That's what he said. Now, was Jesus a proud man? Not on your life. He said, no. He said, I've humbled myself and became obedient unto death. There was no pride in Jesus. And Jesus said, I'm meek and lowly. You follow me and don't lift yourself up. Don't vaunt yourself. Don't be puffed up with yourself. But instead, empty yourself like I have done of all my reputation, pride, and just serve me, meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest unto your souls. Isn't that a little bit like a paradox? It's one of those paradoxes in Scripture. You know, we must die to live, die to self, to live for the Lord. And this is one here. He is saying, take my yoke upon you and you'll find rest. Isn't that an unusual thought? You notice how he puts those two together? Put the yoke. Yoke's talking about work. You go to work for me, and he says something's going to happen. You're going to find rest to your soul. You're going to find real soul rest when you serve me. You shall find rest unto your souls. My, that's a marvelous thought. It is to me. You know what he's saying is, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. We just keep on going. And Paul said it this way. He said, though the outward man perishes, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. And so we find rest to our souls, and we get strength to serve the Lord day after day after day. And then to cap it all off, notice what he says, for my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Some have said, well, I don't know if I want to follow the Lord because it might, you know, I might have to give up this, or I might have to give up that, or if I really get close to God and walk with him like I should, maybe it'll be too hard. Jesus said, no, no, I've got a yoke. I'm going to put you in a yoke. We're going to go to work, but you're going to have rest to your soul. And then he said, I'm going to tell you something. My yoke is easy. If you're not fighting against me, I'm the one that's really going to carry the load. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Now, he starts out with burden, and he ends with burden. You know what he said? If you're heavy laden, if you're burdened down with care, he said, you know, bring it to me. And then he said, my burden is light. You know what he's saying to us? Beloved, what he's saying is this. Exchange your heavy burden for his light burden. You've got a heavy burden you bear? Bring it to the Lord. Cast all your cares on him. And then he will lift you up. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the wonderful teaching that you've given to us in this precious book. And Lord, I thank you. I thank you, Jesus, that you said we could come to you when we're burdened down, when we're heavy laden, and that you'll give us rest. And that we can cast all of our burdens on you. And Lord, we thank you that you'll put us in a yoke with you, to serve you, and that you'll strengthen us, and that you'll guide us in our lives, and we can learn more about you all the time and become more like you. Lord, I pray that you will use us for your glory, for your yoke really is easy, and your burden is light. Thank you. Lord, bless us now as we leave here and go to our homes in Jesus' name. Amen. And good night, and Sunday school at 9:30.